is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope.
AWR Ghana. Voice of Hope.
Voice of Hope.
This is Daylight Magazine, and under this segment, we have Reflections,
Youth Corner,
and Moment of Truth.
I am Kwejo Ansedu, and I'm presenting this with
Hannah B. Nyakun.
How are you doing today, Hannah?
I'm doing well, and you?
I'm doing well as well. I hope, dear listener, you enjoy our programs. Stay tuned.
AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope.
Voice of
Hope. Be ready. I want to be ready. I want to be ready to walk in Jerusalem just like John. I want to be ready. I want to be ready. I want to be ready to walk in Jerusalem just like John.
Oh, John, now didn't you say?
Walk in Jerusalem just like John.
That you'll be there on that great day.
Walk in Jerusalem just like John. I want to be ready. I want to be ready. I want to be ready to walk in Jerusalem just like John.
I want to be ready.
I want to be ready. I want to be ready to walk in Jerusalem just like John.
In Jesus, right in the middle of the earth.
Announcement. Cherished listener, please take note of the change in frequency. Our current frequency of 11955 kHz will be changed to 9830 kHz from the 27th of October 2013 to the 29th of March 2014. I repeat, our current frequency of 11955 kHz will be changed to 9830 kHz from the 27th of October 2013 to the 29th of March 2014.
Jerusalem, just like John. I want to be ready. I want to be ready. I want to be ready to walk in Jerusalem.
Great
day, the righteous marching. Jerusalem, just like John.
Oh, I want to walk
in Jerusalem, just like John. In Jerusalem, just like John. In Jerusalem, just.
Oh, do you have a mirror image? I hope you do. Come join me as we take a purposeful contemplation of our lives. This is the program Reflection.
Experience oneness. Intimacy. What a word picture describing two becoming one. Yet, this is exactly what happens when you pray. Your spirit unites with the Spirit of God. Philippians 2, verses 1 to 2. This was read from the book God's Little Book of Prayer by Richard Daly, and my name is Andrew Boateng-Bexon.
This segment is about the youth and their lives in today's world. The program is Youth Corner.
Aimlessly beneath the barren sky, leave it to me, I lead you home. So afraid that you will not.
Welcome, listener. It's your favorite youth program, Youth Corner. And today, we are continuing with our discussion on when, how, and whom to date. Once again in studio, I have my panelists,
Ansedu,
Donopata,
Esther Senkansa,
John Johnson,
and I am Russell Menta. Panelists, you are welcome.
Thank you.
So the last time we met, we looked at the knowledge of self. How is that possible? We mentioned the family, we mentioned the society at large, and so many other things came up. Today, we are continuing to look at how to date. That is a very, very broad topic, and we are going to break it down into segments. Okay. So let's look at it from this point of view. There's a difficulty for most people who call themselves Christians and the issue of dating, particularly about how to go about it. So what are your opinions on this? Is there a set standard for a Christian that as he or she walks into dating must look up to?
Oh, definitely.
Let's start with Esther, yes.
Definitely. You can't just get up as a Christian and decide, today I feel like dating, so let me just go ahead and date. I mean, you should know what you're about, know who you want to date. And if you're a Christian, then definitely you're looking for somebody who also shares your Christian perspective, somebody who is godly. It might not mean the person being in the same church with you or you attending the same branch of a church with the person, but somebody who you've identified to be godly enough that if you two date, there wouldn't be any religious problems arising in your relationship.
Anything else?
Yes, Esther had made the point very clear. Of course, dating comes with self-test standards, know yourself, knowing the other person and all that. Because you don't just want to know anybody. I like the point that John C. made at that time. Of course, like attract like. Okay, so if I'm a Christian, then I'm expecting that I'll attract a Christian. Now, Esther wanted to brush away the issue of denomination. You know, of course, I feel and say, okay, all Christians are Christians and all that. But it's very important. Now, if you stand for a particular principle and you believe that matters to you, if it can even be in the same church, okay, you might have another church member you might be interested in. But if you really feel strongly about something and that person does not see it that way, it is quite difficult. It's easy to brush the faith issue aside, but it always comes back to haunt us. And so, as a Christian, I will put it this way. You look at what you actually believe in. Of course, you must also go out to somebody who actually believes in that. Other than that, you have some problems along the way. Unless, of course, we are coming back to the point where you say, okay, it's just knowing each other. Then I can go out and know anybody, Hindu, whatever I want and whatever. But let's come and be realistic. I'm a Christian. Of course, I need a Christian to date. And a Christian is not just anybody who calls him or herself Christian by name, but indeed a Christian indeed.
Let me just bring your mind to this point. You know, sometimes we say we want to see an example.
Yeah.
So for a Christian, we want to live like Christ. Mm-hmm. But to the best of my knowledge, Christ was not involved in any intimate relationship that we could say we are looking onto to live ours. There's no precedent, so to speak. And so for the Christian listener, what is your advice to that person? What standard is there? Do I ask Jesus Christ, show me the girl I want to be with? Or what is the standard? What do you do to make sure that you are not entering the wrong relationship? Johnson?
I think from the onset, we said that you're going into a relationship with a person. You say you are dating. And Mr. Asendu said it's not formal. Mm-hmm. And I think we talked about that a lot. And we say in here that in a relationship, you, the one going into that dating, should have your principles and values.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
And ensure that the person that you're dating also has similar values and principles. So you don't have them clashing.
That's right.
And there are certain things that we all know. As Christians, the Bible tells us that whatever that we do, we should do it and ensure that it is pleasing in the sight of God. So when you are dating, whatever that you are into, you need to ask yourself whether it's pleasing in the sight of God. So if it is not, then you have to think and ensure that you don't have to push yourself into things and getting into areas where eventually you're going to fall and commit sin. Because I remember a story a friend told me. That she went out with a guy, and the guy was serious Krefe. In Africa, we say Krefe, meaning a born-again Christian who is all in all speaking in tongues.
Fire, right?
Speaking in tongues. And
very spiritual.
Very, very spiritual person. And I think they went for a movies. And at the movies, the lady accidentally had her palm on the gentleman's time.
Oh my God.
You're watching a movie at one of these, whatever, cinemas. The lady didn't know what message she was communicating to Mr. Christian.
Okay.
So when they left, Mr. Christian also started making advances. And it was like, I thought. I mean, that's what she was saying. And before she could realize, Mr. Christian wants a kiss. And then, let's get home.
Yeah.
That sort of thing. And fortunately for the one who was not too religious, the lady, she decided that I am not ready for something like that.
Okay.
But if she had also been ready, something like that would have happened.
Okay.
You understand? Yep. So it's important that we don't brand ourselves and pretend to be what we are not when we start dating.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's good.
We are looking at dating, and dating boundaries be between one person and the other, a male and a female. Yes.
I can never be between a male and a male.
Yeah. We are not accepting that.
All right.
You wanted something else.
Yeah. So, you know, as an individual, and we are talking about, I'm a Christian here, you should have your own values. And those values would come definitely from the scriptures. You get it? Now, what if you are going out with a person and the person is in the same church and the person doesn't believe what you believe? That is a serious concern. Yeah.
You see, you are in the same church. The person doesn't believe in what you believe in. You see, so as you start dating the person, you see that the person doesn't believe. Yeah. And then you move on.
That's it.
You see, you don't tie yourself down in a date.
No.
Neither should you tie yourself down while you're courting. So nothing of yours should go to that person, and nothing of that person should come to you.
So the maturity we mentioned means that you should be able to realize your similarities, the things that can make you click, and those that can't.
Yeah.
So that as you go on, meet new people, develop relationships, you know who to drop and who to continue to
continue with.
See, one other thing too is, nothing of yours should go to that person.
That's the point.
And that person should also not give you anything. Because if you start demanding from the gentleman, the gentleman will also start demanding things from you. And what he may demand from you, you may not be able to find.
That's a good point. That's a good point.
Okay, I have a question. There are people who also say, all right, I'm a Christian, and God said we should get people in the church and get them to be Christians. Yeah. So I tend to want to go out with somebody who is not really a Christian, but in a way, just try to bring the person into the church and sort of impose my values on the person.
Let me tell the truth here.
The Bible says that do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers.
Now, that is quite loaded, but practically, what that means is, you don't win people through emotion. Let me tell the truth. You go to church and you see people praying in tongues, you know, give the gaga. Now, that's the point. Now, they come back home and they are different people. We know why? Because they were, you know, actually riding on emotions.
So, listener, is anybody worn to church through emotion?
Never.
That's a question I'll leave for you to answer. We've had this discussion today, the fourth part of when, how, and whom to date. And once again, I've had the discussion with Johnson, Ansedu, John Opata, and Esther Nkanta. I've been your host, Russell Mensah. Tune in again for the next part of this discussion. We are out.
World Radio Ghana,
Voice of Hope.
AWR, Voice of Hope. We will bring you joy. Keep hope alive.
You can contact us on
Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, please send us an email through awr@vvu.edu.gh
Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058. Listener, this is the moment of truth, where truth is presented with precision and exactness. Enjoy this encounter of a lifetime.
Most welcome to the moment of truth. And this moment we want to talk on the topic, the God of a second chance. And our scripture reading will be taken from the book of John, chapter 8, verses 10 and 11. But before that, I would like to join you in a word of prayer. Father Divine, we thank you for a moment like this when we can share your word with our friends. And we believe that by your grace, we will understand you and accept your call to walk by you and prepare us for your second coming in Jesus' name. Amen. My dear one, the God of a second chance is the God who has always been calling us from our sins and from our woes to be with him and prepare us for his second coming. This scripture reading, taken from the book of John, talks about a woman caught in adultery. This woman is given no name, but just a description as the woman caught in adultery. And as the verse reads, in verse 10 and 11, I read from the King James Version of the Bible. It says, when Jesus had lifted up himself and saw no one but the woman, he said unto her, woman,
Where are those thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? Verse 11. And the woman said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Dear one, the Pharisees and the scribes were a group of people who disturbed our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for a lot, during a lot of his ministry. And anytime Christ presented a sermon or performed a miracle, they had something to say. And so in chapter 8 of the book of John, we are told that Christ, one early morning, had gathered people to minister unto in the temple. And there came these scribes and Pharisees, dragging a woman into the midst of the congregation, disrupting the whole service, causing a lot of attention to be drawn from what Jesus was teaching unto this woman who has been brought. And as we read in verse 3, we are told by the Bible that the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in their midst, they said unto Jesus, and for the first time they addressed Jesus as Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. And they proceeded, in verse 5, to recall the law of Moses, which commands them that should anyone caught in the very act of adultery, such a person should be stoned to death. And in putting forth or recounting this law unto Jesus, the Bible says in verse 6, this they said, tempting him, that they might have a cause to accuse Jesus. Precious one, as you listen to this story or to this embarrassing situation concerning this woman caught in adultery, I want you to understand that this question put forth to Jesus Christ was to trap him to commit himself into the hands of the Roman authorities. If Jesus had said that they should allow the woman to go scot-free, it would have meant that Jesus has set the law aside. Again, if Jesus had said that they should go ahead to stone the woman, it would have meant that Jesus Christ has usurped the Roman authorities. And by so doing, Jesus will be thrown into jail or behind bars or will be dealt with. Precious one, what I want you to understand is that Jesus is God. And Jesus, knowing the intentions of men, and Jesus, knowing the hearts of these evil men, did not utter a word. And as we read in verse 6, we are told that as soon as the question was put to Jesus, Christ bowed down. And in bowing down, he began to write on the ground with his finger. And when Christ did that, it was an answer the Pharisees never expected from him. But friend, I want to give you a little background to this law of Moses and how the punishment was to be meted out to this woman caught in the very act of adultery. In Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 7, we are told that whoever gets to know or presents himself as a witness in this very act of adultery will be the first person to cast a stone on this very woman or this culprit who is caught in the act. And what we gather is that a mound of sand will be mounted and a pit will be dug in front of this mound, and the woman or the culprit will be asked to stand onto the mound, which will be mounted as high as the very height of this woman. And the person who claims to have caught this woman in the very act, I mean the first witness, will be asked to push the woman into the pit. If by so doing the woman does not die through the falling, then the first witness begins to cast the stone, until all others will continue or will follow up with the casting of the stone. Christ knew the extent to which pain will be gone, will be experienced by this woman. And all he did was that, in raising up his head, he asked the woman, Woman, where are those who have accused you? And the woman answered, with all fears and with all shivering, she said, I see no one. And Christ told the woman, Then I too do not condemn you, but rather go and sin no more. Friend, I want to tell you that we are dealing with a God who gives us a second chance. To some of us, he has given us more than a second chance. But this hour, I want you to know, whatever situation you find yourself, just consider yourself that God is ready to forgive you. If he forgave this woman, the law had caught her, and there was every indication that she will be put to death. But God is a forgiving God. God is a merciful God, and he's ready to pardon us. It is my prayer that as you go through the storms of life, if you have been accused, either falsely or rightly, if you sit in your bed, if you walk on the streets, as you listen to me, whatever situation you find yourself, which presents you in a situation just like this woman, I present Christ to you. If you walk to him, he will give you a second chance. And I believe if you go, you will not sin no more. May God help us. May God help you. May God strengthen you to walk out of that sin so that you will be given a second chance and be blessed in the name of Jesus. Amen. You have been hearing this message from your friend, Pastor Ochilebafo.
Announcement. Cherished listener, please take note of the change in frequency. Our current frequency of 11955 kHz will be changed to 9830 kHz from the 27th of October 2013 to the 29th of March 2014. I repeat, our current frequency of 11955 kHz will be changed to 9830 kHz from the 27th of October 2013 to the 29th of March 2014.
This is our address, Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa.
Or if you have access to the internet, please send us an email through awr@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058.
I am blessed being a part of this program. Hannah, what about you?
The same here.
So I believe, listener, you did too. This has been once again Kwejo and Sendu and
Hannah B. Nyaku.
God bless you.